Hello everybody and welcome to Dark DJ Productions. And today on Dark Tries, we're going to be having a look at this. This is the Southern Railway Bullied Merchant Navy Class 462 Pacific, brought to Train Simulator 2021 by Bossman Games. So, what is the Merchant Navy Class? This was a class of 30 462 Pacific types built for the Southern Railway to a design by Oliver Bullied, and 30 were built between 1941 and 1949. The class were eventually rebuilt between 1956 and 1960 to a much modified design, with 11 members of the class surviving into preservation, all of them rebuilt. None of the original style merchant navies have survived into preservation. However, there is at the moment an idea to rebuild one of them, or unrebuild one of them, into original specification. So, the merchant navies were originally designed as express passenger locomotives, but due to the onset of World War II, they were hastily classified as mixed traffic locomotives by Bullied and his team, so that they could be built during wartime, and they were used on express passenger, normal passenger, and mixed traffic and freight trains. Originally, there were two engines built, number 21C1, Channel Packet, and 21C2, Union Castle. Then they were followed by a batch of eight, which were all built between 1941 and 1942. And later batches were built, a second batch was built in 1944, and a final batch was built by British Railways in 1948 to 1949, making 30 of the class in total. There were many detailed differences between different members of the class. There was lots of differences in the air-smoothed casing, which you can see here. They had many novel design features such as that casing. They had inside chain-driven valve gear. They had electric lighting all throughout, and lots of other modifications and ideas that unfortunately made them quite unreliable in service, hence why they were rebuilt by British Railways in the late 50s to a more regular design with outside wall shafts gear and all of that lot, and the air-smoothed casing removed. So, that's a little bit of history on the merchant navies. As I say, none of these have survived in this condition in preservation. However, one is going to hopefully be quote-unquote unrebuilt into this shape. So what I'm now going to do is we're going to have a look around at the models supplied by Bossman Games and the liveries included. We'll have a listen to the sounds and we'll go for a run with them, probably on a different route. So let's start with something that I wanted to point out, which is unfortunately in the Bossman Games pack, we don't have 21C1 or 21C2 in their very original conditions, with a slight modification to the front cowling, which, as you can see here, is of the slightly modified type, with the cowling at the top there that replaced the Widow's Peak, as it was called, on the original designs. But as you can see here, what we've got is number 21C1 Channel Packet, which gave the class its name of Packets, although they were more known as just Bully Pacifics, or sort of derogatory, they were known as spam cans because of World War II spam packaging. But as you can see here, Bossman Games has represented the class as the locomotive, of course, as slightly modified with the turned out smoke deflection units there. If I move around to the front here, you can see the cast iron front plate there, and you can also see the southern building plate in the middle there, which, as you can see, was originally an upside down horseshoe. This was seen as unlucky by the Southern Railway drivers, and so it was filled in with that plaque there, which, as you can see, says Eastleigh 1941, which made it a circle rather than a upside down horseshoe. And on this particular model, which you have here in the Southern Bullied Malachite Green and also in wartime black, as we'll see in a minute for Union Castle, the first two members had the cast number plates on the front. They also had, if I come around to the side here, this sort of sloping sort of outside shape here, like it's a sort of smooth running sort of tweaked in look to the casing. And if you come around, you can see that there's this casing over the cylinders and over the wheels. And also in the cab as well, you can see on the side of the cab there that the original design of the cab is there with its slab-fronted shape. You can also see here on the side of the cab the 21C1 there, and also on the tender, the Southern in the cast plates. And as you can see here, it's got a very continental look, and the numbering sequence is also different because Bullied took the French approach to numbering. So his Pacifics were numbered 21C1 to 21C, I think it's 21C20, that would have been the final member of the Series 2 class, because they're represented in the game as Series 1, 2 and 3. We're looking at the specifically version of Channel Packet. And as you can see, it's a really nice model. It's very impressive looking, and I don't know, there's just something very chunky about it. I would say that the textures are slightly shiny, especially on the original Channel Packet, because they would have been finished in a slightly different style of paint where it wasn't as shiny, but I can forgive that because it does look quite impressive, and I must admit I'm very excited to have a look at the rest of the locos in this pack. You can see here as well that the nameplates were quite unique, as you can see here for Channel Packet. They were named after, as you can see, they're named the Merchant Navy class, but they were named after shipping lines that were helpful during the World War. So you have engines like Channel Packet, Union Castle, Canadian Pacific, General Steam Navigation, East Asiatic Company. There's lots of different names that we'll have a look at later on in the video. And as you can see, the nameplate's quite unique because they have a circular roundel with the name of the locomotive. They have the circle in the middle with the flag of the shipping company involved. And the two plates on the side, which say Merchant on one side and then Navy class on the other, acts as a class identifier. And as you can see here, represented very well. You can also see the same for the plates here for 21C1 and 21C2. Those were the only two members of the class to have the cast plates. And you can see again on the southern tender. Now, there's lots of variants to look through. So I'm just going to smooth back a little bit here. And I'm going to try and bring the camera up. There we go. Because there's also a lot of variation on the tenders and the tops of the locos. Now, I have covered the Merchant Navy before. I've covered the rebuilt versions. So right now, we're looking at the original version. So this is how they were built, and they were eventually rebuilt, including their tenders. And as you can see here, they have these what are called raves on the top of the tender. It's very flat-sided, just like the sides of the locomotive, which not a lot of people quite realise. But the whole idea of them being flat around the front was actually, and the sides, of course, was for ease of maintenance. Which is kind of ironic, seeing as they were a maintenance nightmare. The idea was that you could shove them through a carriage washer to clean them during the wartime, but sort of never really took off. I don't think it did actually take off. But doesn't stop them looking very interesting. And also you can have a look at the tender here. I really like the sort of like the way that the coal bunker is sort of smoothed around, and it sort of follows the shape of the locomotive somewhat. Gives it a more symmetrical shape. Unfortunately, that coal sort of rave, as they call it, was quite difficult to fill with coal, which is why in later engines and in the rebuilds those raves were sort of taken down and later removed. And as you see here, you've got the air tanks on the back, lots of nice detail on the locomotive. I also noticed something quite nice in one of my earlier little test runs, that the wheels on them, on the tenders, are the same colour as the wheels on the locomotive. You'd think that that detail wouldn't be spotted because of how sort of hidden they are, but actually it's a really nice little detail. So, overall, what do I think of the Season 1 look of the Merchant Navy? Season 1? Series 1 look of the Merchant Navy. Very impressive, and I also like the fact that it sort of looks very different to later Bully Pacifics, especially if you come to the front. You can see here how the sides of the casing sort of fold round towards the buffer beam, and that's something that was only seen on the first series of locomotives, so that's very nice to see. We've also got little steps at the front there. You've also got cylindercocks there. You can, I don't know, I can't remember if you can see, but there's three sets of cylinders anyway, but there is three sets of cylindercocks there. So we've had another look around at the malachite green one in southern livery. Let's go and have a look at the other liveries, and let's also go and have a look at what other versions are included. So first and foremost, we've now got the Series 1, as in 21C1 and 21C2. So here we've got Union Castle in southern wartime black. Now this version, as you can see, has the same cast plates as 21C1. You can see it's got the nameplate on the side here, Union Castle, and you can see that you've got the cast plates there on the side of the cab again, and the southern on the tender. So this is how the first two would have been brought out. They would have been brought out first in malachite, but with the war going on, they were quickly repainted into this plain black livery. And kind of interesting. I must admit, I'm not really a fan of the black. But it looked good on some locos, not so much on the Bully Pacifics, I must say. And as you can see here, well, it's still got the southern roundel there on the front. This was later removed on later locomotives, as we shall see. Because here we are next up with the Series 2 version of the locomotive. And this has the Series 2 front end, as you can see here. It is slightly different to 21C2 over there. Because it has a slightly different curvature to the front. It still curves round, but it's not as prominent as you can see there. It doesn't curve as much. It's not as dialectic, I would say. But as you can see, you've got the casing up around the cylinders. You haven't got the curvature around the wheels that you have on the original design of the locomotive. As you can see there, it's more of a flat shape. And as you can see on this version, I've actually chosen to take the nameplates off, because you can have it either with nameplates in red or black, or you can have them without. And I thought, as it's wartime livery, I would see what Bully Pacific looks like without the nameplates on. So this is the first instance where we see the sunshine lettering that Bully drew. So it was a green and yellow livery. And as you can see, 21C18. I can't remember what the name of this one was, because I took the nameplate off because I'm dumb. But you can also see the southern lettering on the plate there, on the tender. And if we come up here, you can see the slight difference in the tendon too. So instead of all the curvature and the waves and the dial is on the first one, it's a more flat shape on the Series 2 and 3 versions of the locomotive. You can still see the sort of curvature around the front of the locomotive tender, where the cab is. But you can see that it's sort of slightly less curvy around the sides. I must admit, I do prefer the curvy version, but that sort of looked quite handsome as well. So, we move on. So after the war, most of the class were repainted back into the Southern Malachite Green. And as you can see here, we've got another Season 1 locomotive, Series 1, with the slightly different curvature around the bottom of the locomotive. So there is actually quite a lot of variation when you think about it on these locomotives. Especially because you've got like the electric lighting and everything. That's pretty fun to have. And as you can see, it's sort of why the casing sort of bulges out slightly. Because there was actually an incident where I think it's on the original locomotives. I can't remember if it's actually there. But I'm pretty sure on the original locos, the lamp irons, as you can see there, in fact they are on this one, are on the smoke box door rather than on the sides of the case, as they should really be. And that was because they would protrude from the side of the casing and obstruct the driver and fireman's view ahead. So that's why the lamp irons are there. Even though it's funny that they've got lamp irons, because the whole point of the electric lighting was so they didn't have to have them, but it's for the discs, I suppose. So as you can see, they went back into Southern Malachite Green here. Again, we've got another Season 1 loco there. Series 1 even. I keep saying season, don't know why. And then you can see the difference here. Actually, you can see the better difference here between the season Series 1 and Series 2 style locomotive sides, at least. And if I come to the front, you can see the slight difference in the front again there. So, as I say here, we've got the Malachite Green. Blue Star, Merchant Navy class again, with the red nameplate. Bullied style lettering on the side again, and the Southern on the side there. And again, you've got the more stylistic choice of tender here. Next to it is the start of British Railways. So what we have here is number 35016. And this is when the Bully Pacific began becoming British Railways locomotives in early 1948. So they would have kept their livery, but they were now renumbered into a new sequence. So originally they were numbered from 21C1 to 21C20. But they were eventually renumbered into 35001 to 35001 to 35030. Because the last batch of 10 were built in British Railways days, so they never received Bully style of numbering. And as you can see here, you've got the British Railways lettering there in the sunshine yellow, which is probably one of my favourite liveries in the entire pack, I must admit. So this is probably the version I will be driving at the later stage of this video. And as you see, you've got the Season 2, I'm going to keep saying season, so you've got the Season 2 tender, and I think here you've got the Season 3 tender, 6,000 gallon. Somewhere along the lines anyway. I can't really tell much of a difference between the Series 2 and Series 3 tenders, but they're pretty much the same. I think they've just got a slight difference on the rave, or the water capacity is essentially slightly different, because the original tenders were 5,000 gallon, the Series 2 tenders were 5,100 gallon, and the final Series 3 version was 6,000 gallon. So quite a lot of difference in the water capacity. So if we move back to the front, we're now going to look at the next livery, which is this, which is the BR Experimental BR Passenger Blue livery, as seen here on United States line. And as you can also see, we've changed up, so we've got a black nameplate, which I think looks better with the blue. And as you can see, in British Railway days, they became classed as 8P, which was quite interesting, because again, they were originally designed for mixed traffic, but British Railways knew what they were doing. They knew they were really passenger engines, so they gave them the P classification rather than, you know, the mixed traffic, such as what the Light Pacifics ended up being, which was 7P5FA. These were always 8P, which is why they managed to get away with painting it BR Blue, which looks quite splendid on this engine. And as you can see here, by this stage in life, they had been extensively modified again, because what we're going to show you now is the differences in the cabs. So as I mentioned originally, the cabs were front sort of slab shaped, and they sort of came down and were quite flat to the side of the locomotive. And this was kind of a problem for visibility because of the right angle of the window. So in British Railways days, and due to experiencing done with the light Pacifix, they were given these wider cabs which have a different angle. And as you see here, the window is slightly angled, which helps with visibility. So as much as I like the original look of the cab because of how continentally French it looks, they eventually all ended up with these larger side cabs. So this is a BR Blue livery, as I say, it's with the white and black lining. Quite handsome livery. Not really my favourite one, because blue is always one of those interesting colours for an engine. But as you can see here, it comes with the British Railways logo applied, the early British Railways logo. The one thing I'll talk about that I'm quite surprised at is that these things lasted to 1960 before they were all rebuilt. And yet there isn't a late crest version of the high-sided tender, and I'm sure I've seen a image or two of them with them. So I'm quite surprised the Bottom Game didn't include a late crest version, which is kind of sad because I like the late crest. But not to dwell, you can also see here between these two liveries, because this livery we're looking at next is a very experimental blue with red lining. I really don't like this livery, but it is one that they wore. In fact, only one member is known to have worn it, which is 35024 East Asiatic Company. But you can also see here the differences on the front ends. Again, there's so much variation between the members of the class. You can see the casing there on the sides of the cylinders on this experiment livery, but you can see that in later days, and on the BR Green livery we'll look at in a minute, they were taken away. So they fully exposed the front ends and the cylinder fronts. And as you can see here, it wasn't to be there. But this is kind of a sort of interesting take on the Malachite livery, because it's the same sunshine sort of like lining style, but with blue and red. I think this was to experiment on what BR type livery they wanted to have wearing on the big express passenger locos. Unfortunately, as you can see, this one wasn't very successful. I think part of the reason that some of these weren't very good is the finish on them, but that's another story, I suppose. So now we're going to move on to the final livery and final looks. So we've now got the BR Green liveries, and as you can see here, you've got number 35005 Channel Packet. Not Channel Packet, sorry, Canadian Pacific, which is preserved in its rebuilt state. And as you see here, in these later stages in life, they basically began to look quite uniform. There isn't that much difference between them, because they now have their different style smoke deflectors, as you can see, the large, wide smoke deflectors, unlike on the ones in the southern days, right over here, where they were basically just pressed out of the locomotive. Here, they're actually pushed out quite far. And yeah, the BR Green looks pretty good. I still say it's slightly too shiny. And again, I've decided to give the black nameplate on this version. The main difference, as you can see, on the Series 1 to Series 2 and 3 is, again, mainly in the cylinder sides here. You can see that it's mainly because they were squared on one side, whereas the original locomotive kept their sort of curved running, I'd say running boards, but they're not. You know, the curvature over the wheels were the same all throughout their lives. And as you can see, the original style cab has long gone in BR days, and the tenders are still pretty much the same, just with the BR lining and everything on them. And I must admit, that is a very handsome looking tender. I'm not normally a fan of making big deal out of tenders, but the Merchant Navy tenders were just, there's just something about them. They were welded as well, I believe. The whole locomotive construction was welding rather than riveting, which is riveting stuff. But yeah, you can also see the difference there on the later style. I think this is a Series 2 tender, actually, but there you go. That's the liveries that are included in the pack. I obviously haven't put every single variant down because there's lots of variants in the pack. But as a final look, as before we go off to look at the locomotive and give it a drive and have a listen to the sounds and things, here is what could be. So we've now got here 35011, which in general steam navigation, which possibly at the time of making this video is the only Merchant Navy Pacific being possibly backdated or unrebuilt into this original condition. So perhaps one day we'll see Merchant Navy in its original shape again, running on the main line. That would be quite nice, wouldn't it? So as we end this part, I do have to basically make a quick apology, which in that the frame rates aren't very good because I can't get performance mode on the locos unless I'm driving them. So I do apologise if the frames are a little bit choppy. And secondly, I'm sorry if I haven't gone into as much detail as I'd like to. I hope I've gone into enough detail to give you guys a little bit of history and a nice look around at the Merchant Navy Pacifics. So, without further ado, I suppose I'd better cut this part of the video. And we're going to head over to another room. And we'll have a look at the cab. We'll have a listen to the sounds. And we'll go for a little drive. So, let's do a transition. So, here we are, ready to do our test drive of the Bossman Games Merchant Navy Pacific. We are going to be using number 35015 Rotterdam Lloyd in my favourite livery of British Railways Malachite Green. We also have some lovely Pullman coaches from Matrix Trains behind us, and the route I'll be running on is the Golden Age Developments West of England Main Line. We'll be running from Axminster to as far as I want to go where there's scenery, and we'll be going via Honiton and Honiton Bank. So, we're going to have a look at the cab, we're going to have a look at some of the other features on the locomotive, and first and foremost, we're going to come around to the front of the engine and have a look at the headboards that are included in the pack. So, as you can see, we are at Axminster, we are ready with our nice long train, so let's see what headboards we'd like to select and what the other headcodes are. So, first thing first, by using control 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, you can get the headboard discs up, and when you've got the generator on in the cab, you've also got the electric lighting. So let's take them back off by doing the same thing, and we're going to select, I don't even know what the headcodes are, so we're going to do that. So now, let's have a look, if I bring the camera to the side again, so I can show you some other cool features, the headboards and other decorations. So we'll start with, you press H for this one. So you start with the golden arrow, which looks splendid with the large arrow on the side and little flags on the front and the golden arrow headboard. You've then got the Night Ferry headboard there. And there's a variety of other designs, such as these ones. So the most important one we'll be running is this one, probably the Atlantic Coast Express. You've also got the Royal Essex, the Bournemouth Bell. Then you've got other headboards such as the Pines Express, the Thanet Bell, the Man of Kent, British Pullman. Might even run the British Pullman, actually, seeing as we're running on Pullman sets. You've also got the Devon Bell, which is actually probably more appropriate, so I might run that one. Kentish Bell, the Cunarder. You've basically got a very large selection of headboards that these engines would have run with. Maybe not so much in preservation, of which we're going to see one in a moment, which would be something like the Great Britain. I think that one's right at the end of the set, or it could be further back, because for some reason when I go through these and cycle them, sometimes they don't show up all of them. So there you go, there we go. There was the, if I go back again, the Great Britain. So let's go back and select one that we want. Let's go with, let's say, the Devon Bell. So we're going to run the slide with the Devon Bell. So the next thing to do is have a look in the cab. So here we are in the cab of the original condition Merchant Navy. So what I'll do now is turn on the lights. The other lights are still on. So Bully designed these to be quite ergonomic. So there was all the controls were labelled, and I'm just showing you the window section there you can close. Most of the things were labelled in the cab, and they were set out so the driver and fireman could do their jobs in harmony. Now, one of the features that were taken off during the rebuild of these locomotives was the steam treadle, which basically opened the firebox doors, which I'll show you in a minute, without having to use the ratchets, as you can see there, with me manually opening the doors. And you can close them like that. But if I chuck the auto fireman on, which you can do by control R, you'll see that the steam treadle will start working in a moment. There you go. So you can press that on the floor, and the steam used by the locomotive actually helps to open up the firebox doors. So another feature on the original conditions that is not on the rebuilds is the steam reverser, which you use by holding E to open it up like that. And you can move it forward like such and back as such. You can probably see the little handle moving there. So we're going to put it into forward gear, and then you can lock it by releasing it. Those are the main features that I can see that are different. Injector controls, regulator, reverser. You've got the brake in front of us, this large thing here, which I'll just release now. And you've also got the electric lighting as well, as you can see. So if I switch that off, you can see that the dials and things there are still lit up. I can switch them off like that and back on again. Very nice feature. But if you've got a low-end computer and you really want to try these, if you do Control-Shift-P, you'll see in a moment if I can get the fireman to open the firebox again. In fact, I may well just turn the fireman off for a moment. You can also drag that seat down. And if I open that up, do Control Shift P, you turn performance mode on, which turns off the point lights in the locomotive. So if you struggle to get good frame rates with the locomotive, try that. I, of course, am going to turn it back on because I'd like the full experience today. You can also do things such as open up the side doors, which I'm going to do. And I've closed the windows. And if you come outside, you can see that the windows have slightly closed. But we're going to open them up because it's a hot day in Devon. And you've also got a roof vent there, which I think you can see has just about come up there on the roof. So you can get some nice ventilation. It's a very nice place to be, this cab, actually. Kind of pleasant, especially watching the fireman do his work. So, close the firebox. That should mean that the fireman will start using the treadle again. So, what cab views you got? You can come outside the cab here. You can come out the cab side that way. At the front here. Up a little bit. Pulled right back. Probably one of my favourite views in the cab because you can see everything you want to do. Down by the firebox. And then up here on these controls. And back in front of the main controls of the locomotive. So, without further ado, I'm going to turn up the sounds on the game. I'm going to shut my mouth. And we're going to go for a drive from Axminster on the West of England main line with the Bothman Games Merchant Navy Pacific. Let's go. So, that was the Southern Railway Bullied Merchant Navy Forcing 2 Pacific for Train Simulator 2021 by Bossman Games. I hope you all enjoyed the video, and I will see you all next time. Goodbye.